Everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. We've got a special one for you this week. We're going to spend some of the store's money, actually. We're going to crack some stuff open.
Yeah, we have to crack some packs and some event decks and everything. So we're starting here with the Mirrodin Besieged event deck. This would be the Mirrodin side. I don't know if it actually has an... Oh, Into the Breach. There we go. That's the name.
Mono red deck. We've got the preview here.
So I'm not exactly sure what an event deck is, but we were sent it by Wizards and...
It comes in a sweet deck box.
It does.
Let's already start out by saying...
And with a nice spin down dice that you shouldn't be using to roll to see who goes first. So let's see. We've got a sideboard here with some Unstable Footings, some Searing Blazes, Active Treasons, Goblin Rune Blasters, Into the Core, and Leyline of Punishment. This actually looks like a real sideboard. I don't like a couple of the cards, but most of this cards actually looks like a sideboard I would make for a constructed deck.
They're all playable.
Yeah.
It's not like a joke.
Right. So here we've got, let's see, Memnites, Ornithopters, Signal Pests, Goblin Bushwhackers, Goblin Guides. All right. Kuldoth Rebirths. So this is a Kuldoth red deck.
Surprisingly close to a tournament one.
I mean, I could make this into the deck we tested in the Pro Tour with just a few changes. It's got, Iron Mirror, Spikeshot Elder, and Darksteel Axe, which we weren't playing any of. But past that, it's got Lightning Bolts, Galvanic Blast, Devastating Summons. It's even got a Contested War Zone and a bunch of mountains. So earlier we added up actually the amount of money that this was worth.
It's in the mid-40s range. Again, right now on shelffireball.com, you can pre-order or order, depending on when you watch this. This deck for $25, the other one, the green-black one, which you don't have today, for $20, or you can actually get the pair for $40. So already, if you were to build the deck you're looking at right here without any changes, you're looking at, again, over $40. You can get this deck for just $25 or the pair for under the price it would build just to build this.
So more exciting to me than all that stuff is the fact that this deck's actually pretty sweet.
It's playable.
Most of the pre-constructed decks they make aren't really what you'd call tournament playable. Which is fine. People will buy them and they'll play against their friends, the dual decks, and have fun. And I think the dual decks are actually great, by the way. I'm, looking forward to the next ones. But it kind of sucks when someone buys a pre-con deck and then goes to play FNM, a standard tournament at the local store. Now I have a deck. Let's play in this tournament. And then they just get trounced.
Right.
Whereas you could play this with zero changes, and I think you'd have actually a pretty good shot at doing well. There's not really much you need to do to make this completely tournament playable. And as it already is tournament playable.
And that was, obviously that was the goal when Wizards had the idea of the event deck.
I had to make sure to get my Starbucks money for sponsorship.
Yeah, as soon as we see a nickel of that money, someone please let us know. In the interim, I forgot what I was saying. This deck is totally playable. You could take it to an FNM, not only have fun with it, but probably win some rounds. It's pretty close to, again, what Luis would build if he was going to play Kudolf the Red.
Were I to spend $20 upgrading the deck, so I'd take out Spikeshot Elder, Iron Mirror. I would take out the two Darksteel Axes. And I think I'd take out one of the Galvanic Blasts and three of the Mountains.
So again, that's one Iron Mirror, two Axes, one Spikeshot, one Blast, and actually three land.
Yeah, well, the deck, it starts out with 22 land in it, which is a little bit high. Granted, the version we were playing for practice for Paris had Mox Opal, but even without Mox Opal, I don't think you need 22 land.
You're going to change the sideboard a little bit in the immediate future, and you're not going to be casting a lot of spells that cost four.
No. In the main deck, the most expensive spell costs two mana, so you don't really need, that many lands. If you want to add a little money to the deck, I'd add two Goblin. You definitely want to max out on Goblin Guide. It's one of your best cards.
It's like the first card that you need to...
And I'd go up to three Contested War Zones as well. And then you also definitely have to add two more Goblin Bushwhackers. Because if you're playing Devastating Summons and Kuldoth Rebirths and all this stuff, you need four Goblin Bushwhackers. That is a curious oversight. It's not like it's an expensive card.
Right.
So I'd add two Bushwhackers, two Goblin Guides, two Contested War Zones, and two Chimeric Masses, which is a rare but a pretty cheap one. And
yeah, it's still right around $20.
Chimeric Mass is a lot better than Axe, because it costs zero when you just want an artifact to sacrifice. So that's cool. You can go turn on Kuldoth Rebirth. It also gives you a way to use excess mana, casting a 3/3 or a 2/2 or something like that. And you don't want to spend all this mana equipping Darksteel Axe. So
especially when we're cutting the lone Spikeshot
Elder
out of the...
Those are some pretty easy changes. If you wanted to do even more, if you had Mox Opals lying around, this deck could use a couple Mox Opals as well, and then probably get rid of most of the Galvanic Blast at that point. And then in the sideboard, there's not a whole lot of changes,
because
I actually like most of the cards. But I don't like the End of the Cores because they're just way too expensive. This deck can't play spells that cost four. And there's not that many artifacts you care about. Swords and stuff like that are just too slow for it.
I think, I mean, you know, we just saw some Tezzeret decks being played in the immediate future. I think they're kind of planning forward where we're going to see more artifacts.
Yeah, but the Tezzeret decks are going to beat this deck with, like, Pyroclasm or, like, you know, a Tezzeret make a guy, like, not necessarily something or into the core is that great. I mean, I guess it's good against Tezzeret itself, but I would probably cut the Leyline, the two into the cores, and a Searing Blaze for something like two Arc Trail, two Cunning Spark Mage, which are pretty insane in the aggro matchups.
Yeah, not only good in the mirror match, but also kind of deals with all those Squadron Hawks running around and other various ones.
Yeah, this is a pretty sweet deck. I don't know what the Black-Green Infect deck looks like because we don't have a list for it, but I'd imagine it's a little, that'd be a little tougher to port to playability in for Standard than this, just because, I mean,
right now,
this is actually just a Tier 1 deck.
Right, I mean,
Tier 2 at the very least.
It helps that we're looking at a deck that you're already very familiar with and you know that constructed playable.
Again, we tested, you know, 52 of those 60 for Paris and thought the deck was fine. Like, we didn't think the deck was bad, and we, in fact, sideboard a lot of cards against it because we were worried about it. And, that turned out pretty well for us. But
I mean, you've got to be pretty happy if you're going to go to your local FNM and you show up with absolutely nothing. And for
you can spend $20 and $25 and get an actual playable Standard deck.
Yeah, it's definitely a new kind of adventure for Wizards.
It's pretty sweet.
Yeah. I will say that the cards kind of have that gloss that's a little bit different than, like, cards out of a pack. Like, if you played with any of the deck builders toolkits, they kind of have, like, that same kind of gloss.
You can see a blurb from me in the instruction manual in the deck builders toolkit.
Self-promotion whenever possible.
don't raise your eyebrows. Oh, yeah, they're always like that. All right. So, moving on to something a little more exciting, let's crack some packs.
Woohoo!
Here, why don't you go first?
So again, it's so nice now that the pack order has changed.
Yeah, because it used to be when the new set would come out, be like, all right, let's crack a pack, assuming you're in this color. Like, right. Now we can just open Besieged and go from there. So, what's the rarest? It's the first thing I look at every time.
We have a Shimmer Mirror.
Shimmer Mirror? All right. Well, that's a playable, but it's not great.
I mean,
some decks it's pretty sweet, but.
Oh, I see a good one already. So anyway, we've got Quicksilver Geyser,
yeah.
Razorfield Rhino, Fangren Marauder.
There we go.
Bladed Sentinel, Spire Serpent, Serum Raker, Virulent Wound,
okay.
Rot Wolf, Fuel the Cause, one of both of our favorites, I think, Ichor Wellspring.
Yeah, it's a nice one.
Pierce Strider, Videlkin Infuser, Nested Ghoul, and then the Shimmer Mirror.
All right, so I already know what I'm going to first pick out of this pack. But
let me just look at my colors. Okay. Wow, no red cards.
So the cards that I would consider first picking would be Fangren Marauder, Ichor Wellspring, and I guess Rot Wolf, and that's about it. I mean, Pierce Strider, the next best cards are like Shimmer Mirror and the Peace Strider, and Nested Ghoul is actually fine too, as is Serum Raker, but I mean, the bar's pretty high for first picks for this set. This is actually a somewhat disappointing pack to open, but it's pretty easy here. I don't think actually it's even remotely close. I think Fangren Marauder is by far the best card in the pack and the best first pick. The fact that the next guy might pick a Rot Wolf is pretty relevant, especially since Infect and Fangren Marauder, I mean, they don't fight that much. So,
I mean, again, I've heard Ben S. talk about how amazing that guy is. You can really just win games with Fangren Marauder. It's only a single green.
I mean, if it's any sort of race that doesn't involve them trying to infect you, and you play this guy and an artifact dies, all of a sudden you're winning the race and they're on the defensive. I've seen so many games where you get one or two of these guys out, then your opponent's like, well, I guess I got to deck him because he's at 70. Like, yeah. It just happens like that. So if the Fangren Marauder wasn't in the pack, I think I would probably take Ichor Wellspring, which is pretty underrated, but I wouldn't necessarily be incredibly happy about first picking it. Again, when Webb was looking through all the rares for this set, he noticed that like half the rares were good. Like, if you're not first picking a Bomb Rare or Uncommon, or at least like a Burn the Imperial or something, you're actually kind of below the average opening pack, which is kind of funny to think about.
It's kind of awkward.
Like, Fangren Marauder is one of the top like three or four commons in the set, and first picking it is still somewhat below average. So that's just how good this set is. But yeah, I mean, I still wouldn't be too unhappy to end up with Fangren Marauder first pick.
Or even that Ichor Wellspring. I know that you did a lot of work with that card.
Yeah, I mean, it's good with Glint Hog, Glimmerpoint Stag, Rusted Slasher, like even Oxford Daredevil and Faerebor, stuff like that. So, all right. Ooh, a Hexblade Golem. I like that. This pack already.
I want to hear more about that.
The rare is, of course, Decimator Web, is our nickname for David Ochoa. it's a fine card. I think I like it a lot in Sealed, but I would not want to first pick it in Draft.
It's actually pretty nice here that we're 2 for 2 on packs where we don't just
slam
windmill
rare.
The rare.
Yeah, in Paris they filmed a little segment with a bunch of us where we'd each open a pack and say what we'd pick. And like I opened Consecrated Sphinx, Kibler opened like Phyrexian Rebirth. It was just like, yeah, these are tough picks. So past that we've got crap, Steel Sabotage, Rusted Slasher, Treasure Mage, and Skinwing. So this is also a fairly below average pack, but out of this pack, I would actually just take the Treasure Mage. I actually like that guy quite a bit, and there's a Hexplate Golem in the pack that's almost assuredly going to wheel, because not only is he underrated, I mean, this pack's, it's full of reasonable cards, but not great cards. So it's not a pack I want to first pick out of, but it's a pack I'd be pretty happy to see fifth.
Is there any chance that Steel Sabotage is going to table, or is that card just too good?
No, so like one of the things you look at when you open a pack is what's going to table. So you're at an 8-man table, assuming you take Treasure Mage, right? The cards that I expect to be gone are Steel Sabotage, Rusted Slasher, Skinwing, Quicksilver Geyser, Decimator Web, and then probably the Green Giant Growths. And that's 7?
Yeah, we're at 7.
Yeah, so those are the other 7 people they're taking.
It's kind of awkward that it's 2 green cards, 2 blue cards, and 3 artifacts.
Well, I mean, the red cards suck. Tyne Strike is not actually good because white, in fact, is not actually good. And Lead the Stampede and Pista Strike are both fine. But yeah, I mean, there's no red cards. And the fact that you're passing blue cards or whatever, it doesn't really matter. Again, don't concern yourself with signals too much. You're just going to overthink yourself. I would basically never take a worse card than a better card just because of the signal it sends. Like, that's just not worth it.
So if it's one like, if the blue card is the best card and there are 2 or 3 more blue cards in the pack that are playable, and one like white card that's not as good as the best blue card, you're not taking that one white card.
Always take the blue card. Always take, well, not even because it's blue. If it's the same as true, like, if the pack has, like, you know, Slagstorm and Burn the Impure and Cooled with a Flame Fiend, and then there's also, like, you know, a Spread the Sickness or something like that, like, Cooled with a Flame Fiend is so much better than that card that even if you're passing, even if you know 100% the next 2 people are taking red cards, it does not matter. You should still take the best card. So, if it's like, Burn the Impure versus Spread the Sickness with 2 other red cards, no other black cards, that's different, because those 2 cards are actually very similar, so that could influence your decision. But I would not downgrade quality because for a signal. So this pack's pretty also clear. Actually filled with cards. I'm not 100% sure those are the 7 cards that would be taken, because who knows, someone might want Tyne Strike, or someone might see a Lead the Stampede and have 7 creatures in their deck and want to take Lead the Stampede.
But again, like, even if you like,
regardless
saw
of
back
how it looks, I
a
think,
natural predator, yeah. Like, you're still in all likelihood tabling that 7 drop guy.
Yeah, and that goes really well with Treasure Mage. I think this is a legitimately very good combo, and Treasure Mage helps if you open or get past, you know, a ridiculous bomb. So, I mean, doubling up is insane.
Like, okay. Well, I mean, again, you're the king of value, so yeah, I can definitely
exactly.
See, like,
again,
your first
this is
pick.
This isn't a great pack, but if you're not taking Treasure Mage, what are you taking? Like, a Skinwing is actually fine too. I would not. Looked at anyone who wanted to take Skinwing because it keeps you open and is reasonable. But the 6 equip cost means I'm actually not that impressed with this card. Unlike most of the living weapons, it doesn't feel as much as like a 2-for-1 because you almost never equip it. I mean, it's still a 4-mana 2/2 flyer, but
it seems like a draft game would have to go pretty late and mildly stalled in order for that
exactly.
That Skinwing to come back as more value, which again, you're really looking for when you're drafting.
Well, I mean, that's how I draft. So.
Oh, all right. I mean, I do like that. You're getting a first pick and almost an assured 9th pick. With
yeah,
the Treasure Mage.
Even though it's not great.
Again, we've opened 2 packs where you're kind of under the curve
yeah,
for how we feel
this
about
this. One much more so, but I mean, still. All right, let's see what you can make. See if we have something absurd yet.
I think we'll just pull out the key ones if we're not going to. Well, I guess, who knows. Got a Gust Skimmer, a Master's Call.
Rare.
Oh, right. Sweet, we're 0-for-3. We got Knowledge Pool.
Ooh, the Knowledge Pool, yes. That card's not remotely playable.
All right, meanwhile, Master's Call, Gust Skimmer. We have Phyrexian Rager, Rusted Slasher, Banishment Decree, Rotwolf, Flare Husk, Sphere of the Suns, Plague Mirror, and Core Prowler are the mentionable.
What would you slam out of this pack? Wrong choice of words. You're not slamming anything.
I know. I was like,
what would you take out of this pack?
Probably the Core Prowler, actually.
All right. So that's... Actually, just not right. But,
okay. Well, that's again a million D drafts under his belt. Zero.
I know. I'm going to explain. Yeah. I'm not making fun of you yet. Core Prowler is actually a card that people tend to overrate for whatever reason.
Okay. I mean, good timing.
I saw even like even Chion, you know, thought this card was a lot better than it was. But as it turns out, if you want to take an effect card, I think Rotwolf and Plague Mirror are just like they're both better than Core Prowler. And Plague Mirror in particular is actually really awesome. Even in non-infect decks, he's still like a mirror. He still accelerates you, even if he doesn't fix your colors. But he also, when he blocks a guy, gives it a counter. So he actually has use later in the game.
Right. It was one of those things where, like, how often do you play off-color mana mirrors in triple scars?
Very often, and Plague Mirror is better than all of them. So.
Right.
Past that, there's really not a whole lot. I mean, if you want to take infect cards, Rotwolf's very good. He trades for a guy and draws you a card, and there's really not much they can do about it in the early game. So Rotwolf would be probably my number one pick here. But if you want to keep yourself open, Plague Mirror is actually a fine pick there, too. I might actually even just take the Plague Mirror just so I'm not locked into any particular color. Core Prowler is, again, a little worse than both those guys. Sphere of the Suns is much worse than Plague Mirror. Flare Husk, Banishment Decree, Rusted Slasher, Phyrexian Rager, and Gust Skimmer are all fine, but none of them make me want to first pick them. So we opened up some pretty bad packs. We're not even probably wheeling anything too relevant. I mean, maybe a Master's Call out of this pack. So let's see if I can redeem ourselves with our last pack here.
Now, Master's Call, it seemed kind of overrated going into playing Limited for this format.
Yeah, it's, I mean, Metalcraft is just not as good as right. it used to be.
Everyone's like, instant Metalcraft, it's got to be really good.
All right. Rare.
Home run, just make this really easy.
Spine of Isha. So not a home run, because there are uncommons I would take over it, but I'm probably going to first pick it. Whoop. And yes, definitely. So the viable commons we have are Leonin Skyhunter. That's about it. Treasure Mage again, Pierce Strider, and Spine of Isha. So here I would definitely just slam the spine, because it's actually just very backbreaking to play this and then sack it to something and then play it again. Mm-hmm. And it's not that hard to set that up. You can get Rusted Slasher, even Oxida, Daredevil, Ferrovor. Those are all Nathosaur. Those are all legitimate ways to sacrifice spine. So, and if you're really lucky, you'd wheel Treasure Mage. I mean, that's not going to happen, but this is a good combo. Owen had that combo going, and he top-8ed GP Denver with it. So
this is one of those circumstances where you can't go the opposite way, though. You can't.
You're not wheeling Spine. No chance. He's no Hexblade Golem.
Seven mana Vindicate for any color. That's totally
so. I mean,
okay.
Besides that, like you've got Pierce Strider, which is actually a fine first pick for an aggressive deck. Leonin Skyhunter, if you really want to cut white and end up with a deck like Martin Juzes from the GP Denver top 8, and a bunch of really mediocre cards like Virulent Wound, Dross Ripper, Scourge Servant, Tangle Mantis. So. These have not been the most difficult packs.
Choking Fumes, not that good?
No, it really isn't. Like, white's not only very aggressive, so this is like too defensive of a card. It's also not that hard to play around once they know you have it. If they don't know you have it, you can sometimes get them pretty good. Like, Kilbrook got me in one of our practice drafts when I attacked him with Plague Stinger and Phyrexian Digester on turn 4 or whatever. It's just like, boom, and that was game. But if they know you have it, it gets much, much worse. So, again, an easy pick. You slam Spine and... that's where you go from there. So, hope you had fun watching us crack a bunch of products today. It's kind of fun. Now I want to get online and record a draft with the assistance of TSG.
Woohoo! Hopefully I have something more insightful to say than don't take the Prowler.
Don't bet on it. Thanks for watching.
Almost 15 minutes. Pretty good.
That's what she said.
Cut! The table killed me.
Yeah, how did it?
Wow. What are you doing?
It was broken. I guess someone broke it when they moved the table in there for the feature match. And so we're kind of going to need to tape it together. Go steal one from IKEA.
Well, it's just the little leg there.
Did I ever tell you that I
someone can
limb
fix
before?
It.
Yeah.
If you know a good woodsmith.
A woodsmith?
You
know
a good... I don't know.
What is a woodsmith? I figured that out when I broke it on camera.
You broke
our
camera?
You just kicked it.
the particle wood, not very good. It's in fact pretty shitty.
Good job, Luis, you big ogre.
That's definitely a camera. Good job, Luis, you big ogre.